Thank you, worship team. Thank you, Mapu. So many years we've been praying and asking the Lord to clarify the vision. We want to fulfill the vision that God has. And for many years, I think the first 5 years, we kept getting Samoa, and we kept getting Polynesia, and then God will expand to the Pacific Rim. And so this is happening way before I went to Argentina. God was already slowly giving us kind of a foretaste of what he was going to do in our church, where he was going to send us and for our church. So when that day, that Sunday after the Holy Spirit Break Conference, and I said, Kathy, Danny, Siki, my mom, praying in our native tongue, it was a confirmation that God is preparing us to reach nations. In Psalms chapter 2, verse 8, God says, ask me for the nations, and I will give you the nations as an inheritance, but the earth as your possessions. I want to let you know that your pastor has been asking God for the nations. That I've been asking God, Lord, give me Polynesia. Give us Polynesia. And give us the other nations. Give us the Pacific Rim. And this is not my prayer per se. This is when I meet with God, his Holy Spirit, as I submit to his Spirit, he is telling me to pray these things. And so I want to let you know, we right now are there. That God is moving and he's waiting on us. And he's inviting us. This is our territory, church. This is our mission field. It begins here. This is the base where we get the equipping and the training. But it's actually outside the church walls is where we minister. The equipping, the fellowship, the loving, the repentance, the getting cleansed, which is so critical. This is where we start. But then it goes into your homes. It goes into my homes. And it goes into our communities, and our schools, our marketplace, in Hawaii, starting in Hawaii, and then spreading to the nations. How many of you guys know? And next week, Dawn O'Brien will be testifying here. And her testimony, her story, is related to our mission. How many of you guys know that Sage Tolentino, on March 17th, is traveling to Shanghai? Wow. Sage, Grant, Becky, why don't you guys come up? I'll let Becky start and then you come. Come on. Both of you guys can hold the mic. And come front and center. You guys are the feature story. Okay. So maybe both of you guys can tell us, why is Sage going to Shanghai? Just that simple question.
He was selected out of 70 kids that played basketball in his school. He was selected in top 9. Anywhere between 7th grade all the way to 12th, he was selected 9.
Yeah. So how many of them going to Shanghai?
20 of them. 20. 10 kids and a couple adults.
Okay.
And the coaches.
Oh, wow. Yeah. But as far as students, just
students. 10.
Wow. And by the way, is Shanghai the only place this year that he's going to?
And then in June, first week of June, he travels to Tahiti. Yeah.
So what was the cost for these trips? And these are all on behalf of Marino. And yeah. And so they're going for educational purposes. Yeah. And but this, the cost of, at least for Shanghai, how much is
when it first came out, when Becky, when I was in building the prayer room, actually, Becky says, hey, they want Sage to go to China. How do you feel about that? And I mean, in the prayer room, hey, let's pray about it. Hey, he says, go. So I go, how much we got to pay? She's like $200 to $500. During the Punahou Carnival, we ran a fundraiser of parking, charging $15 a car for 4 hours. The first half, we made like 8,000, and there are 3 shifts, so I think they made like 16,000, enough to cover the $200 out of the pocket cost, so it's free. He's going to.
So you're going for free.
For free, yeah. And then Tahiti's trip is also free due to all sponsorship. Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, all free.
So not a dime, not a penny out of your guys' pocket.
Not a penny.
Not a penny.
Yeah.
So you can give the mic to Sage. Sage, what do you think, in addition to the educational purposes, which we're going to bless, do you feel that God has, there's a godly reason why you're going to China and to Tahiti?
Because he's giving me an opportunity to go, and it's a big privilege for me to go, and he's giving me a path where to go and stuff.
Amen. Do you feel like there's some things that God wants you to do while you're in China?
To teach Chinese people about English and teach more if they don't know God or stuff.
Amen. 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 You know, the natural eye going to think, this is cool, this is amazing, it's a blessing, but can God really use this? You know, about 3 years ago, I would go to Vegas for our kids' sporting events, and I would drive to the city, and the Lord, and I would be religious towards the city, and the Lord said, stop doing that. My son bled for this city, and I want you to see this city the way I see it. And I repented, and I confessed, and I started to pray God's blessing. And I would just kind of, just out of obedience, Jesus said, bless us, so I'm blessing you. Every time, driving from Larry's house to the city, going back and forth numerous times, and each time I get in a car, Lord, bless this city, bless this city. Then all of a sudden, my heart begins to change for the city. And this would happen over a period of time, years. You know, God answers our prayers. You know, God not just hears our prayers, but he actually moves on our prayers. So when Tahine went up this past summer, there's people in Vegas and in Arizona saying, we want Tahine in Vegas. Do you guys, okay, you guys' response, my point is better than you guys' response. You guys not understanding.
Amen.
Tahine carries ecclesia. Because I knew that God would send us to Vegas. And the thing we got to be careful is, he could do things by his way, his time. So don't have any preconceived notions of how things are going to be. So we still got to pray and work that out. May God use you, Sage, to bless China. Because it's not about WMC. It's about what God wants to do in China. And he may use a 6'8", however tall you are, 13-year-old student. So, church, let's pray for the Tolentinos. Father, we thank you for this family who loves you, who follows. Shayla, why don't you come up, Shayla? Yeah. A wonderful sister. Father, we bless the Tolentino Ohana. We thank you for their love and care for you. We thank you for their service, their sharing here in WMC, Lord. Father, we thank you for the provision on this trip, Lord. And we also ask that you would bless the family, Lord, that you would bring peace, comfort over mom and dad and Shayla as Sage departs on the 17th. And Lord, Father, we just pray for an anointing upon Sage, your spirit to be upon him, that in informal and informal ways you would use him to plant seeds, Lord, that he would carry your peace and your blessings, Lord, and your love all over China, among his teammates, among his coaches, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, for the work that you're going to do in the Tolentinos, in Sage on this trip, and through Sage. We bless them, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Yep. Thank you. No problem. You're welcome. I can use that. So, Sage, Shayla, you guys can go with the youth. Just wanted to impart that. It's not just for one particular youth. It's for all of our youth, that that our God would use every single teenager for his purposes. But you know what? We're not just ministering to China. We also want to minister to Tonga. The damages that Tonga sustained during Cyclone Gita. We have an opportunity to sow into our ministry, to sow into Polynesia in a very tangible way, not just with prayers, but with actual materials. So Danny, why don't you come up and you can share what you shared with me that was from the Lord, and then our church will have an opportunity to sow.
Thanks, Rob. many of you may know or just finding out today, but the Pacific got hit really hard, and it started off in Samoa, but I think Tonga took up much of the impact, and then it died down in Fiji. But when it happened, my heart didn't say stop, go help Tonga, and I really didn't pay any attention to it. And through spending time in prayers, one day God just said, this overwhelming, like, when are you going to rise up and do something, you know? And so it was about 2 in the morning. So I just got up and started writing the pen, putting pen to paper, drawing up a plan, and felt like God was saying, make a difference, you know? And it felt just so in alignment with what we learned in Holy Spirit, and then moving boldly into it. So the following week, I met up with Pastor Ellie every Wednesday. And so I was sharing with him the vision that God gave me. And, he advised me on a couple of things. And it was just a confirmation. And then how God worked through positioning things, the opening door, is definitely of him, because I couldn't do it, you know. And so it's really exciting, but my heart started to cry. And, just remembering where I came from, and it was a great experience to know that I can make a difference. You know, sometimes I think we look at what we have and what we can't do, and when I surrendered to him, he was like, "This is what I can do." You know, and so we have a container going out to the Pacific of donation. Not asking for monetary, for money donation, is water, food. They're really in need of water, drinking water. And water, food, sugar, rice, one bag, can of food, whatever you can donate, we'll greatly appreciate it. The deadline is March 15th. And I do have some flyers in my truck. Want to drop stuff off. Unfortunately, I have to leave on the 7th to go to the mainland to do some work, but I won't be back till the 18th. But there's a number on my Facebook page and a flyer on who to contact and drop stuff off. And if you need stuff to be picked up from here and taken to the container, we can do that as well. I'll have somebody arrange to pick up. But, I think the hurricane is just a seed that's planted, that's opened doors, you know. And God, as we all know, God works mysteriously in so many ways. And I feel like that 2 a.m. Call upon my life is to partner with. I didn't think of WMC at the time when I shared with Pastor Ellie, but when I shared it with Pastor Ellie, I started moving into action. I made call to Mattson to ask for support, and one of the head guys directed me to, they have a nonprofit organization that they actually could bless us with, but you know, I didn't have a nonprofit. So when I shared it with him, he said, hey, we can use WMC as a nonprofit, you know. And so things are just falling in alignment. There's a gentleman we fellowship with at the church who works at Mattson, and he's pushing the issue over to their nonprofit organization, part. So, things, it's just aligning. I know it's of God because it couldn't come this far, So definitely in alignment with our vision of ministering to the Pacific, not just Tonga alone, but Samoa, Fiji, Tahiti, all throughout the Pacific, making a difference.
Amen. So next Sunday, so right now you got between this whole week to go and make purchases. Go on an app and you can find out the specific items that they need. Go and purchase these things if it's on the desires of your heart. Give, purchase what you can afford, and that's your offering unto the Lord as a blessing to Tonga and probably the other islands as well. But bring them next week to church, and then we'll store them in here, and then we'll find a way to transport all the supplies to DHX, right?
Yep.
That's the company that's going to carry them. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to have you guys as families. So here's what's going to happen. One is you have an opportunity to sow, okay? And then the church will give an additional offering. And I think it's in line that we have on that day, next Sunday, Don O'Brien speaking, who is part Tongan. So it's God is bringing the church together for the world. And this is what it's all about. Anything else?
No, it's funny. I never foresee it to go this far. But when I got myself out of the way and moved in the spirit, God did the work, And one of the things that really hit home for me as I continue to meet with Pastor Ellie, he's been saying that for 3 years, but it just finally made sense.
Yeah.
He said, when you pray, when you work, you work. But when you pray, God works.
And let's put God to work.
Just understanding how to tap into that source and not try to do it on my own. It's been grateful. So,
man,
appreciate you.
All he needs is a couple of loaves and 2 fish. And he can do some good damage.
Amen.
So, Father, we just submit, Lord, the plans to you, Lord, the provision that you would put it on people's hearts, but also on our hearts of WMC as a whole, as we sow in to the ministry that you've called into our care, Lord. Father, we bless the finances, Lord. We ask that you bless the people involved. Bless all the resources and logistics, Lord, so that the people get what they need. And we pray that, Lord, that you would remove any kind of demonic activity to try and cause this precious cargo to be lost or to be mismanaged, Lord. We pray that the food resources would go to the people who are in need. And that, Lord, that when they receive it, Lord, that they would connect with you. They would commune with you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Bless you. So just more signs of what God is doing in our church. Today I want to talk about unlocking the power of prayer. Powerful prayer. Prayer is the easiest thing to do and the hardest thing to do all at the same time. And it's really going in line with the series about taking the land, taking the fulfillment of God, the promises of God. Those things you and I got to apprehend. As God took Israel and God took Moses, God took Joshua up on a hill and says, look at the land of milk and honey, a land of abundance that's for you, that's for your family, and it's for generations to come. That you and I need to have a vision. What is the vision that God is putting before you that's for you, that is for your family, and is for the future generations of your family? And it got to be apprehended. You and I must go after it. And in order for us to actually achieve it, we need many things, but the perhaps most important thing is that we need prayer. We need prayer in our life. We need to increase our prayer life. We need to deepen it. We need to strengthen it. It needs to be more frequent, and it actually needs to be longer. God hears our prayers, but how many of you know God doesn't move on all prayers? There are specific prayers that he actually responds to in a greater fashion. It's not necessarily because one person is better than the other, but it has more to do with one's heart. And prayer is not about manipulating God. Prayer is not about asking God to give me what I want. That can be prayer, because prayer is simply talking to God. But that's not the heart of this message. But we got to see that prayer brings about action. In Exodus 33, verse 7, it says, it was Moses' practice to take the tent of meeting and set it up outside, set some distance from the camp. Everyone who wanted to make a request of the Lord would go to the tent of meeting outside the camp. This is the lifestyle of Moses. Just as God used Moses to set his people free, God wants to use you to set others free. So this is for not just other people's salvation, but it's for our own salvation. It's for us to be rescued. It's for us to be delivered from sin, from strongholds, and from issues and challenges. This is a practice. This is a discipline. And this is the lifestyle of every follower of Christ, who is actually advancing the kingdom of God. It should be in everybody, but it's not in everybody. The reality is only in a few. And because of that, the reality is this: God is moving and working mightily only in the few. It's not that God is in opposition or resistance against the crowd. It's simply this: the crowd don't do what the few are doing, which is very sacrificial. It was not just a practice of Moses, it was a practice of all biblical characters. The list is long. And if you would look at the modern day saints of the last two, in other words, powerful men and women, children of God, outside the biblical context or characters, you can find people who actually moved heaven on earth, who God used as a mighty chosen servant for his purposes, are people who prayed with great passion, with great intensity, and great perseverance. Prayer was not just an action, a practice, a discipline. For them, prayer was a way of life. Just as much as you and I need to inhale and exhale, these kind of individuals saw prayer in the same fashion. Like they couldn't do anything unless they first pray. Oftentimes the crowd is this: I'm going to do whatever I can, and if the can doesn't work, and then I'm going to pray. Prayer becomes a third, fourth default for us. And that's why we get in trouble. Whereas for those who are close with God, prayer is the first thing that they do. And it's not just the last thing they do, but it's prayer sustained continuously throughout the journey. This is also a practice of our Lord and Savior, our Master, the Son of God. That Jesus often withdrew to the wilderness for prayer. He constantly. There's two things we got to pull out from these two verses, just these two verses alone. Number one is they both had a place that they went to meet with God. There's a specific locale that they visited in order to meet with God. And both places is outside the camp. For Jesus, it's in the wilderness. He went constantly to the mountain. He went to places of solitude, not to isolate himself and sever relationships with him in the community. He is basically saying, I have emptied my cup and I need to fill it up. Let me go and meet with my Father to get refilled. Do you have a place where you go to meet with your Father? Do you have a prayer closet? If you do have one, do you use it? As far as I know, everybody need one. And whatever you post, verses in the prayer closet, has to be a reality. Has to be true. As a child who had this amazing gift from God, ever since he was 9 years old, he could see angels and he could see demons. He was never afraid. Because for him, it would be like walking in a zoo and seeing a caged lion. So he would see demons crawling all over people. He would see demons whispering in the ears of people. He was seeing doing what demons do, and he would see angels fighting off demons, protecting those who are righteous unto the Lord. At the age of 9, this was an everyday occurrence. It's not like once in a blue moon. This is every day for this young boy. At age 13, things began to change. One night, the demons actually started to break through the cage and were tormenting and terrorizing him at the age of 13 in his bedroom. This went on for 3 years. And he knew, I just got to speak the name of Jesus Christ, talk about his blood, stand on the word of the Lord, and declare the testimony and authority of God over the demons. And he would do that at age 13. You know what would happen? The demons would laugh at him. Until he learned that those words got to be a reality in his life. That when you say, I rebuke you in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ, you got to believe what you're saying. And only when the demon sees that you believe, that's when they're going to submit to the word. Until then, the fight continues, the tormenting continues. See, the reality of God's word is seared in us when we pray. It's not until you actually live a lifestyle of prayer and in the word till you go through life experiences that you realize that God's word is true. So many people ask me, Eli, how do I know, how do I prepare for ministry and things like this and having greater intimacy with God and being used by God in a powerful way? I said, You need some battle scars. Well, I went to Bible school and have all this knowledge and information about God's word. And I'll say, good. But you ever been stabbed in the back? You ever been betrayed? You ever been mocked by your own people? By God's people? My point is, if you've never been broken for the Lord, then you ain't ready. Until then, get broke. Be broke for his name's sake. And then you'll be ready. All of this is forged in prayer. We need to have a prayer closet, individually and corporately. And that's where God is prepared. This is why we're having this message, because down the road, God is going to call us to have a 24/7 prayer church. That's in season. No sense promote that right now when we're not praying. No, the first prayer closet is in here. And it's you and Jesus meeting with him, meeting with one another. See, when a prayer starts becoming true, authentic, passionate, and a lifestyle in us, then we can add some programs to it, some structure to it. It needs to be burned in us. In Exodus 3:7, then the Lord told him, I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I've heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. Yes, I'm aware of their suffering. You know, prayer is a response to God moving in our life. So many of us, I think, approach God this way with prayer. Lord, I'm suffering. Don't you see it? Lord, I'm broke. Don't you see it? Lord, I'm in pain. Don't you know what's going on? Lord, I have all these issues in my family. I have tremendous baggage, tremendous bondage. I'm isolated. I need your help, Lord. Don't you see what's going on in my life? Are you blind, Lord? You know that God sees everything that's going on in your life, even the stuff you don't see? It doesn't mean he's going to move, but it doesn't mean that he's going to come running to your help, to support you. No, this verse tells us, when I heard their cries, then I moved. I saw the slavery, I saw the bondage, but I didn't move until somebody said, I need you, God. I want you, God. See, that's cry. It's not like, Lord, if you get time, I don't want to inconvenience you, Lord. I know you got some other things you're doing, but if you could work it out in your schedule, because we've been in slavery for almost 400 years, if you get, no, a cry is a broken heart. You're in an ugly place if you're crying for God. You're in a place of pain. And God is saying, well, that's when I show up. Psalm 34 says, he is near to the brokenhearted. Until your, not just your heart broken, but hear me clearly, until your prayers is with a broken spirit, oftentimes God will not move in a mighty way. So if we're wondering why God ain't moving and working in our life, the question we got to ask ourselves is, are we asking him to? A prayerless life, you will find inactivity of God in their life. If you and I are not praying, God ain't moving. Do you know how long from the moment that God saw his people as slaves and the point to that he actually sent Moses to deliver him? You know how long that window is? 150 years. God saw the slavery, but he never moved until some people cried. So you could be suffering for 40, 50 plus years, and he knows full well what's going on in your life, but he ain't going to do something until you actually start crying out. Consider yourself blessed if you have people pray for you because they're crying on your behalf. They call intercessors. So if you wonder how God moving in your life when you never actually reach out for him and crying out to him in prayer, that means somebody praying for you. And if you find out who they are, you best bless them. Because they saved your life in the name of the Lord. This is a powerful statement. Prayer moves God. Prayer causes God to work, to labor on our behalf, for our blessing, for our benefit, for the fulfillment of his purposes, not our purpose. I don't want my purpose. That's how I get in trouble. I want God's purpose for my life. I want his will. I want his desire. I want all that he has for me. Because Paul said he can give you greater than what you can even ask or imagine. I can get creative. And God said, that's all. Look like a little flea market carnival over there. No, I get something bigger for you. But let's turn to Exodus chapter 32, verse 9 to 14. And we get more examples of this reckless love of God. So the context is that Moses is having this face-to-face encounter with God, exchanging tablets. Excuse me, not exchanging. God is handing Moses the tablets. But while Moses is meeting with God, God's people are going back to their old ways in idolatry, making this golden calf. In verse 9 of Exodus 32, it says, "And the Lord said, I have seen how stubborn and rebellious these people are. Now leave me alone so my fierce anger can blaze against them, and I will destroy them. Then I will make you, Moses, into a great nation." But Moses tried to pacify the Lord, his God. "Oh Lord," he said, "why are you so angry with your own people whom you brought from the land of Egypt with such great power and such a strong hand? Why let the Egyptians say their God rescue them with the evil intention of slaughtering them in the mountains and wiping them from the face of the earth? Turn away from your fierce anger. Change your mind about this terrible disaster you have threatened against your people." What's happening is that God is about to do and hand out a major sassing on his people. He was about to wipe out that people and say, "You know what? You know what? I'm going to wipe everybody out, and I'm just going to start one nation from you, Moses." Here's what we got to know. God just needs one person. If you ever think that I need this, I need that, I need this, no. He just needs you. Are you willing to suffer like Moses did? Now, are you willing to drink a bitter cup like Jesus? That's the big difference. So the King James Version, it says that God repented. We think that repent means to turn from sin and turn to God. So if we use that version, it implies that God sinned. No. To turn from sin, to turn from God, is the fruit of repentance. The meaning of repentance means to change your mind, to turn your mind, to renew your mind, that you think like God. In Jonah chapter 4, verse 2, I don't know if you remember the story of Jonah. God calls him to go and preach to the Ninevites. And he never liked, because the Ninevites were, by their lifestyle, were deserving of great judgment by God. So Jonah, who is righteous, said, "No, these guys are unrighteous. They deserve judgment. They deserve death." Eventually, Jonah, who hard head, finally surrenders and says, "Okay, Lord, I'm going to do what you tell me to do." He goes to there and just gives a simple message: repent of your ways. And God, who was about to massacre these people, he relents, he changes his mind, and he offers mercy towards the Ninevites. And that upsetted Jonah. And Jonah got upset. He said, "Look, this is why I never like follow you in the first place. This is why I never like do what you told me to do. You know why? Because I knew once I gave them message and they responded with repentance, I knew that you was going to forgive them. But deep in my heart, I wanted you to slay them." See, Jonah says in his letters, in his book, saying, "I know that you are a merciful God. None of you and me can ever change that character, the heart, and the nature of God. None of us can make God, who is mercy, unmerciful, who is gracious, ungracious. You and I cannot do that. But what we can do in prayer is change his mind." That's how powerful prayer is. Matthew 15, Syrophoenician woman, begging like crazy to Jesus, hassling, heckling Jesus. "My daughter, who is tormented by the demons, I need you to heal my daughter." Jesus responds with this: "I came for the Jews, then the Gentiles." That's God's timeline. That's God's plan. Are you a Jew? No. Well then, you're going to have to wait. I'm not going to heal your daughter right now. But this lady keeps pressing. She keeps knocking. She keeps asking. She keeps on seeking the Lord. And then finally, the Lord says this. After she says, I know God's plan is first for the Jew and then for the Gentiles, which is me. But if I can just get crumbs from the table, that'll be good enough for me. And that's when Jesus says, then your daughter is healed. You look from Exodus all the way to the New Testament. When people ask God, and they ask with perseverance, and they ask with persistence, and they ask from brokenness, God comes through. So my question to us is this, are your prayers carried by your heart? Are your prayers real? Are your prayers authentic? Are your prayers casual or covenantal? Are your prayers part-time? Or your prayers full-time? In Joshua, as we're reading, before they actually get into a battle, God tells Joshua, this is kind of weird if you think about it, before you guys get into the scrap, grab a flint knife and circumcise all the men. We're going to battle, Lord. What's the purpose of circumcision? Circumcision is all about identifying with God. Circumcision is all about saying, I belong to God. My life is wholly devoted to Him. I live for Him. I love Him. And whatever commands He has, I'm going to do it. Why? Because I love my God. And my God is for me. They never had that kind of relationship with God. So God is saying to Joshua, if you want to win this war and be successful in taking the land, you need to have a covenant with me. It's the reason why David was to slay the giant. Because he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? He's basically saying, yeah, you're a big dude, you're a big boy, you're a man of war, that's cool. But do you have a relationship with God? Okay, sorry. I do. So even though you and fighting, you and I fighting in the natural, what's actually happening is that you fighting with God. And God is on my side. So it's real simple for me. You're going to die real quick. Because he knew what covenant meant. And I wonder, so many of us have a legal relationship with God, but I don't think, you got to judge for yourself, is it an authentic covenant relationship with Him? You know why Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss? He betrayed Jesus with a kiss to reflect his true relationship with the Lord. We know each other based on casual levels, not covenantal. Having a casual relationship with God is having prophylactics with God. Is having God, experiencing God with a level of protection. When people outside of marriage have casual sex, premarital sex, they use protection. Why? on the physical sense because they don't want to receive STDs. But on our heart level is this: I'm meeting with you so that I can get what I want. And I'm going to use this protection for my benefit. In the case of marriage, the number one reason why there's adultery, because there's no intimacy in the marriage. There's no connection in the marriage. There's no oneness in the marriage. They ain't talking to each other. They ain't listening to each other. So this is basically what they're saying. You ain't giving me what I need, then I'm going to find someplace else to go shopping. All of that is casual, church. That's all casual. But in a true covenantal relationship, sex is viewed this way as a gift from God for the marriage. Sex is this: how can I please you? We don't need protection. My job is to protect you. Your job is to protect me. We in this together. We long term. This is for life. I'm fully surrendering my life to you and you for me. We look to care, protect, and walk with each other through life. No matter how stormy, no matter how bad, messed up, broken life may be, you are with me, I'm with you, and God is with us. That's covenantal relationship. That is only built by connection and prayer. See, what God does in the flesh, in the Old Testament, is a sign of what he can do on the inside of our lives. The sad part is this: we live in the new era, but we act like we're living in the old era. We think that we're actually having sensual relationship and connection with God, but we really ain't. You're letting God cut off our flesh, because that's the whole purpose of circumcision in the Old Testament. The word means to cut, specifically excess flesh. Why? Because here's the thing. And I've done, this is what the Lord, I'm just letting you know what the Lord showed up in my meeting with him. I said, Lord, why circumcision of the flesh on the male body? Of all places, why that place? So I did some research. And the medical field says this: there's no real established reason why we do it and why we don't. Oftentimes it's done for religion and just for man's tradition. But on a medical level, there's really no reason whether you get circumcised or not for males. But they all gonna agree on this: it's for greater pleasure. Church, when the Lord prays with you, he wants pleasure. He don't want no protection. He don't want nothing to cover true intimacy. That's why God says in the Old Testament, sever the excess flesh. Because that flesh can get in the way of our intimacy. In the New Testament, Asi, can you open that up? This is what Paul says in Romans. A true Jew is one whose heart is right with God. And true circumcision is not merely obeying the letter of the law. Rather, it is a change of heart produced by God's Spirit. This is what the New Testament era is all about. Your heart and my heart constantly needs to be circumcised. Daily. Yeah, but I received Christ 20 years ago. Yeah, I got married 20 years ago to Becca, but guess what? I still got to feed the log of our fire and love for one another. Same applies to Jesus. Yeah, the last time I talked to Jesus when I got saved. So does it mean you guys intimate? No. So allow Jesus to break your heart in your prayers. Allow Jesus and the Holy Spirit to cut your heart. Look at you. Anybody get calluses? You don't have to raise your hand. You get callus on your feet? Callus on your hands? Right? You know what callus is, right? It's hardened, dead skin. It has no use. Well, same applies to your heart. If there's flesh on our heart, in other words, that we being more dependent upon ourselves rather than the Lord. Enjoy your stay in Egypt. Because that's where you're going to be. See, a heart that is circumcised by God seeks praise from God, not from people. Our church is being radically changed. There's some things in here that I'm not liberty to share, where God is moving mightily. What does it mean that we're going to minister to Polynesia? Let me give you an idea. We had a meeting in our church specifically for women. And out of the women there, I think it was 11 or 12, either 10 or 11 of them have been sexually abused. That's happening in our families. That's happening in our people. And it needs to stop. And it's your job and my job to actually change that. And it starts in our own families. It starts in your family. It starts here in our own church. And we go to other churches. And then we go to the Pacific. Because understand this, yeah? On a spiritual level, so if you have eyes to see and ears to hear, hear me through the Holy Spirit. It's a demonic principality that is running our people, that's saying it's okay for this to happen. It is natural. It's cultural. Don't tell anybody. And if you do, you're the wrong person. Church, that's a lie from the demon himself. So if God is calling us to Polynesia, it's your job, my job, in the name of the Lord, to actually go and bring righteousness. That's only one of the systemic plagues in our people. On a national, on a global level, it's off the charts. See, in order for us to actually make a difference in just in that arena of our people, in our ministry, you gotta pray. You got to know how to pray. Because I'll tell you this, not everybody's going. Why? Because if I know you ain't ready, you're going to die if you come. And I don't want that to happen. So prayer is to be more intimate with God. But prayer is your form of being equipped to do the job that only God can do. But you gotta be willing to live that kind of life. If we're going after nations, you gotta learn, we gotta learn how to fight in the heavenly realms. And you know, fight. You know, in Ephesians, yeah, there's only one weapon that is used for offense, to advancing. You know what that weapon is? There's actually two weapons. The first is the sword. The word of the Lord. The second weapon is here, your tongue. When you pray, that's the second weapon. When you pray and you pray with the word of God, this is what happens. Then your prayers becomes authoritative. Because you're praying God's word. You're praying his truth. And the enemy got to flee. But like the little boy who saw demons at night, it got to be your reality. And that happens by, if you don't have a prayer closet, go build one. If you have one, go and vacuum, take out the cobwebs. And start making your home in the prayer closet. Trust me, God is going to show up. God shows up when his people pray. If my people shall pray. That's conditional. So I'm willing to do this, but are you willing to pray? This is covenantal, church. That's not like, Lord, do this for me, and then I go back to your old way. That's casual. That's methodical. That's insensitive. That's legal. Sad truth. Get plenty families who legally married, but they ain't married. Be careful. It can happen to you and me with God. Saved and sanctified by the grace of Jesus Christ, but don't know who Jesus is. Want to get to know the Savior? Pray. Lord, break our hearts to pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all be blessed.